not a meiotic protein, as you'll see. So it's, but it is how our studies on meiosis got us to focus more on germ cell development. So I like to start with this, which is our cycle of life. And really, all of this is about the egg and the sperm, because that's what really maintains immortality. And really, it's not just about the single cycle, it's about maintaining mortality for generations. And as we know, in this mother, not only is her daughter, in this case, developing, but her daughter's ovaries are developing. So not only are we laying this generation and the next one, but two generations down. And since Pat Hunt is in the audience and Terry Hassel, I just have to take a nod to point out that any exposure to this woman can profoundly affect not just the next generation, but several generations beyond. And you'll see in what I'm going to talk about today how trying to understand a little bit the epigenetics of germline development could have profound influences over many generations. And so we studied this actually in the nematode C. elegans. So what I wanted to point out is sort of how similar, or the overall, even though germ cell development looks very different, potentially, across these species, mouse, flies, and worms. Really, the major features are actually remarkably similar, from the specification of the germline, migration of the germ cells into the gonad, proliferation, meiotic entry, and development, and egg and sperm development. And if we look more closely at this, in terms of the specification, even very early on, the mechanisms by which the germ cells are actually specified, whether it be through the distribution of particular components into a primordial germ cell or the inductive process that we see in the mouse, there's still general features that are conserved across these species, and I'll just highlight a few of these. Specifically, to basically have the germ cells develop properly, we need to have transcriptional silencing, which restricts, basically keeps the germline quiet and restricts germ cell fate. There's a bunch of, it's going by itself. Hopefully it's not flipping slides by itself. Germline soma interactions that regulate proliferation and differentiation, and a bunch of conserved RNA regulators that control germline specific development. And then when we look in the adult germline, although this ovary and this extruded gonad from the worm also look really different, there's a lot of other features that are similar between them. Proliferation and a stem cell niche, syncytial development, folliculogenesis versus enrutment in a gonadal sheath. During meiosis, prophase arrest, there's an attrition process in both organisms, and there's hormonal signals regulating it. And so really that hopefully underscores a lot of the similarities between these organisms and gives you some insights into why we think we can learn a lot about germ cell development from the nematode. So I want to just remind you about how development early development of the germline works in C. elegans. And so I'm showing you here the initial divisions. I remind you that in C. elegans that development basically is invariant. And so from the first division to the final divisions, we basically know where every cell goes. And the germ cell is allocated through these posterior divisions into an initial cell called P4, which then divides twice to form Z2 and Z3, which I will refer to as the PGCs, or the primordial germ cells. And this process occurs through the differential segregation of germ granules, or P granules, into the posterior cell, which are defining its fate, and you can see here, helping define its fate. And Dustin's lab has really worked out a lot of the importance of these germ granules, or lack thereof, in different aspects for maintaining fertility. So I'm not going to belabor that point. We use it exclusively as a marker for following this cell. And then we can see that P4 divides into Z2 and Z3. The larva hatches out with these two primordial germ cells, and then upon exposure to food, these cells divide and elaborate the germline that you saw on the previous slide. And throughout development, a key regulator of this process is the nanos family of proteins, and that's a conserved protein, or family of proteins, not just in C. elegans, but from flies to humans, that seems to have a conserved role really in regulating and maintaining fertility. And so we got involved in really trying to understand aspects of primordial germ cell specification by comparison of the localization of nanos with a protein that we've been working on. So I'll just show here, this is the nanos2 protein, which is called NOS2 in C. elegans. It's hard to see here, but it's actually cytoplasmic in P4, and then cytoplasmic in C2 and C3. It's actually maternally deposited, and then it sort of swaps its role with the NOS1 gene, which comes on later during embryogenesis and sort of subsumes the role of the nanos family through larval and adult development. And we've been working on a factor, XND1, for X non-destruction factor 1, and I'll talk about its adult meiotic roles a bit later. And what we saw with XND1 antibodies was that XND1 was localized into the primordial germ cell. So we actually, very first time, we accidentally had embryos on the side when we were looking at our adult germlines. And I saw this expression, and I said, this is something that's going to be really interesting. Like, you don't exclusively localize to the primordial germ cells and potentially not have a role. And so I was really excited. I'll point out this is in the nucleus instead of the cytoplasm of like nanos of a P4 cell as well as Z2 and Z3. And what's hard to tell in these pictures is it's actually localized to chromatin as early as that cell divides. And then we see it maintained in the adult germline, and I'll show you the adult localization of it later. So the question is, guilt by association, if you're there, you're probably doing something, maybe. And so what happens in XND1 mutant embryos? And so when we looked, we saw dramatic phenotypes, or potentially dramatic phenotypes, in germ cell development. And what we really saw was that half of the embryos had a unique phenotype, which is what we call the 1PGC phenotype. And so instead of having two primordial germ cells, we saw a single primordial germ cell, and you can see that here. And sometimes that was associated with somatic P granules. And then sometimes we saw somatic P granules even by themselves, and you can see that potentially better in this image right here. So we quantified that, so half of them have a 1PGC, half of them are born with two primordial germ cells, and wild type is always two. And then a little bit at a time, we see about 30% extra somatic cells having P granule components. We didn't think that this defect was due to, say, a developmental delay later in embryogenesis. So it could have just been that at the time window we were looking at, that cell hadn't divided. Because when we look at that hatched larva, again, 50% of the time, we could see this single primordial germ cell. And I should say they seem to hatch at about the same rate. So it didn't seem to be a somatic delay as well. So then the question is, what's actually the nature of this defect? And so what we did is relied on time-lapse imaging to look at the embryos through to hatching. And so what I'm showing you here is two different XND1 mutant embryos. And what you can see in this top embryo is that very early in this image, so about this single primordial germ cell divides into Z2 and Z3, but the appropriate timing compared to wild type. And you can see those two are maintained throughout until hatching, and this larva has two primordial germ cells. In the lower embryo here, we can see the germ granules here in green. You can see that we have P4 designated, and then it's maintained, but the cell basically never divides, and those larvae hatch out with a single primordial germ cell. So that suggests that the defect is really in a defect in the P4 cell not dividing, rather than other models such as the cell was born and then dies, rather than it's not associated and migrating into the with the somatic gonad and being sort of left in other parts of the embryo. It really seems to be that the major defect that we're seeing in the mutant is a failure of the P4 cell to divide. I should say, if you have questions during the talk, please interrupt me.
I'll interrupt.
Sure.
So then during larval development, when you only have one PGC, you still have two distal tip cells, and you still have two gonad arms in these strains, right?
So remember that immediately after, so 4 hours post-hatching, they in theory start to divide. We haven't actually started to look at, we didn't actually go out with, because once they hatch out in these movies, they start crawling away, because the embryo experiments aren't done with paralysis at the same time. So we haven't actually looked at movies of the different, of the larval stages, but I'll show you, they still form two gonad arms, right, that develop. So we, I don't want to say never, but almost never, would see something that didn't have two gonad arms. And I'll come back to, you'll see that in a minute.
Okay.
So what was also interesting is that when we looked at this arrested P4 cell, so this is now comparing wild type Z2 and Z3 with this arrested P4 cell, and what you can see is that it's significantly larger. And this is of interest because there was data from that suggested that the that Z2 and Z3 are actually arrested in G2. So it's not that this large cell is in G2 and these are in G1, and it's not just a question of ploidy. It didn't seem to be just a question of ploidy, and we don't really understand why this cell looks unusually large. But we did start to explore the cell cycle component of these cells. And it actually led us to something interesting, not so much about XMD1, but more about the primordial germ cells themselves. So we used two different markers to look at the cell cycle regulation in the primordial germ cell. The first is cyclin B. You can see here in wild type that cyclin B, and these are the adult embryo, the embryos. DNA is in green, cyclin B is in pink or red, and the pigle marking the germ granules is in blue. And that'll be hard to see, I think, obviously, on the slide. So I'll just focus your attention on the insets because it's really a lot easier to see in those these images. And what you can see is that cyclin B accumulates in the PGCs, whether you have two, or in XMD1 mutants, whether you have one. So that suggests that these cells really are primed for mitosis. So the minute they start to eat as they hatch, they're really ready to start to do this job because they're going to have to build this huge germline, right? But they're really, but they're not dividing. So even though they have cyclin B, which is normally one of our markers of mitosis, when we look at other markers, specifically phospho-CDK1, what you would expect is that this would, you need to dephosphorylate CDK1 to enter mitosis. And so you would expect that they might still have the phosphorylated CDK1, but in the Z2, Z3, in wild type or in XND1 mutants, which have two PGCs, we don't see the phosphorylated, oops, my little circles got moved. We don't see, as you can see right here, the phosphorylated CDK1. And so that suggests that there's actually a novel sort of arrest phenotype in the wild type Z2 and Z3. And Matt Michael's lab has really taken over looking at the cell cycle regulation of these cells because it really suggests that there's a novel G2 checkpoint. What's unique is that when we look at the single PGC in the XMD1 mutants, what we see is that we do have phospho-CDK1. So that would be clear because they're not entering mitosis. So this is sort of the canonical and expected arrest point for a cell that would be in G2 ready to divide, or you know, not yet ready to divide, but has cyclin B and then just needs to be phosphorylated to move on. Okay, so Dustin brought up the point that normally you have two primordial germ cells and they elaborate the two gonad arms. And there was work from Judith Kimball's lab that had basically shown that if you ablate either Z2 or Z3, you can get an animal which has just a smaller germline. And so there was actually some debate. In some of their animals, they saw this, and in some of their animals, they saw only one germline arm developing. But all of the animals ended up having reduced fecundity because they only had one primordial germ cell contributing. So we wanted to know, in the case of the animals born with a single PGC developmentally, what was the consequence of having a one PGC? And what we saw in all XMD1 mutant animals is that they develop with small germlines. And so here's now an extruded gonad stained with DAPI. Just mark these, the mitotic region and the different meiotic regions, and the oocytes down here. And what you can see in the XMD1 mutant embryos is that they all have smaller germlines. And I've marked these as fertiles and steriles because a subset of the XMD animals are actually sterile. And all of the sterile animals appear to have smaller germlines, although there's sort of the basic organization in many of these germlines. They clearly don't develop any sort of normal oocytes. Many of them don't develop normal oocytes, and they're all tend to be much smaller. Okay, and so we quantified sort of the growth of the germline over time, and what we can see is though initially these early divisions looks almost like they're catching up. So even to that one, the quantification of the numbers of cells at these early steps during larval development would suggest that that one PGC, once that worm is exposed to food, would start to divide. It was ready to divide, and it actually almost catches up with wild type, but then it starts to sort of not be as good. And when we looked at mitotic index using phosphohistone H3, which is what we could see is that basically it looks like there's fewer mitotic germ cells in the XND1 mutant. And so we think that XND1 has this role in regulating cell cycle early, as I showed you this arrest in P4, but also that it's required to maintain cell cycle because we can see fewer proliferative cells later. Interestingly, when we look at the other consequence of having one primordial germ cell, we could see an epigenetic effect, or passed on effect. So this is the number of hatched embryos with one PGC or two primordial germ cells, the brood size. The average brood size from one is about 40, and the average brood size with two is about 100. So already, sort of, even though they can elaborate a full germline, for whatever reason, the ones that are born with a single PGC, on average, have fewer progeny and smaller germlines. But that's also inherited. So the adults that have one primordial germ cell are much more likely to have progeny that have one PGC than the animals that are born with two primordial germ cells, despite the fact that they are XND, so all of these experiments are done with F2 or F3 XND1 homozygous mutant animals. So they're maternal or grand-maternal homozygotes. Question here.
So the progeny of the one PGCs that do have two, are their brood size normal?
So the brood sizes of the two PGC animals on average are always this, irrespective of whether they came from a one or a two.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Now I'll say the N number on that is low. And there's one of the incredibly frustrating things about the XND1 mutant phenotype is it's incredibly variable. And so this could explain some of that variability. Like there are worms that could have 150 progeny, and there are worms that can have 5 progeny. And those 5 could have animals that would then have, because of this, would have 150 progeny. And so I would love if anybody in this audience has any ideas on how to explore that aspect of stochasticity, because it's really one of the most baffling components of this phenotype to us.
So I'm just thinking about the stem cell potential of PGCs, and maybe Judith Kimball was just at JAX last week, I guess week before, but and in her model, the PGCs will continue to divide as long as they're getting notch signaling. So in this case, when you have one PGC, why can't it make the full,
it's still making a full germline, but it's compromised so it must be like that whatever else is happening in these animals is not actually about cell cycle regulation. So far the defects I told you are about cell cycle and about the capacity, but those animals can still make a pretty nice looking but slightly smaller germline with maybe 150 germ cells that they're producing. So we do think, and we have not really looked well at the male spermatogonial phenotypes, right? So we do think that there is some hit to sperm, and we haven't looked carefully at whether the sperm are more affected from the one PGC versus two PGC. But it could be a sperm development component. We do see genetic interactions with PUF8, and in those cases, we think there is an aspect of potentially premature switching. So if there's so it's the elegans, you develop sperm first, and then you switch to oocyte development. And so if you change the timing of the switch, you can produce fewer sperm. And so these genetic interactions that we're seeing are suggesting the possibility that there might be a subtle change in the timing of this developmental switch, so they might produce fewer sperm overall.
And your metric for brood size, is that hatching out, or is that just, okay, yes, so number of hatching embryos.
Right, yeah. I'm not going to discuss apoptosis, but and so it did look like, so in terms of apoptosis, it looks, because that would be another thing that would contribute to the potential brood, is if you get a, if there's an effect on the oocyte, if there's some damage in the oocytes, you could apoptose more and you could end up with fewer eggs. And so it looks like XND1 mutant embryo, or mutants, fall into potentially two classes, and the fertiles and the steriles. And the fertiles seem to have no change in apoptosis, but the steriles seem to have an increase in apoptosis. So I don't think this is attributable to a difference in apoptosis, because in this requires that they're fertile in the first place. One of the things that's interesting about this inheritance was that I had initially noticed that these animals get sick over time. And so an experiment that I actually did was to look at whether passaging these worms over many generations caused what's called a mortal germline phenotype. And so what I basically, so what this graph, and this graph will show you that there seems to be this progressive sterility that accumulates in the population. So what each box represents, each, down each row is 10 different founder worms who then founded 12 lines. And so across is a line. So if it's black, that animal went sterile. If it's light gray, you know, there's 20 to 50 progeny, and then 50 to 100, and occasionally over 100. So you can see most of the time there's very little white, so the population size was low. But you can see that there was progressive black as we moved on in the generations. The other thing I want to point out is that sometimes there's junk. So how is it that there's something that was, had almost, half of them are sterile, but now they have fewer than half? And that's because if a line went sterile, I rescued it with one of its cousins, and then I asked, like, to really be sterile, to have gone truly sterile, the whole line needed to have gone sterile, and it couldn't even have any siblings or cousins around to do that. And so in these cases where there's truly back, it went completely sterile. But these jumps are some of what I was talking, that they would have very few progeny than a lot, and some of it is because if they went sterile and I tried to rescue it with a cousin. But progressively, what we were seeing is sterility across generations. And when we looked at the brood sizes, what it looked like is if they had a brood, there is a reduction. And it looks like there's this critical point around generation 6 where the brood size sort of stabilized around 20 for this overall population. And what that, but you say, well, that's not going to zero. And the reason it doesn't go to zero is they had to have had a brood size here. So it looks like once they hit a point of having 20 progeny, it was like quantum. They either didn't have progeny or they were fertile. And so there was something about that threshold in it, which we do not understand. Okay, so there's progressive sterility, and this one PGC epigenetic component could be potentially contributing. So I'm gonna come back to the epigenetics in a little bit. But I wanna segue a little bit to trying to understand, I mentioned that XND1, that nadus is maternally contributed, and in the early embryo, there is no zygotic. The very early embryo, there's no zygotic transcription. So we presumed that this early expression of XND1 was maternally contributed. So we wanted to look at the potential roles of maternal and zygotic XND1 proteins for these phenotypes that we were looking at. And so we did that using a set of different crosses. So here, we wanted to look at the zygotic null. And so we crossed hets to homozygous males, and we collect these two classes of mutants and compared them. So here's having both maternal and zygotic protein, and here's having only the maternal protein. And when we do that, we again can see that the maternal XND1 protein is indeed confined to the primordial germ cells, confirming that this early vocalization of the protein is from maternal proteins, or RNAs that are translated into proteins. And the consequence of that is actually that they have smaller germlines. So it looks like the maternal protein is sufficient to get them through to have an almost full germline, but not completely normal fertility and reduced germline size. So we do sort of the reciprocal crosses then, shown here, to have a maternal null and then ask about the function of the zygotic protein. And I want to point out that if we're looking at the localization, or sorry, the expression of this protein, we brought in a GFP transgene from the males, and we could ask then when the GFP XND1 protein is expressed. And when we looked at the expression, we started to see expression of the XND1 proteins at the 250 cell stage. So this is zygotic expression in the primordial germ cell. So this makes XND1 the earliest known primordial germ cell marker in C. elegans. And it really suggested that at least zygotic activation of genes or a subset of genes could be as early as the 250 cell stage, which is pretty exciting. And then when we asked what the effect was of having zygotic XND1, we found that it couldn't rescue the loss of the maternal XND1. And that's shown by two ways. The first is the percentage of dead embryos. There's a meiotic role that causes aneuploidy. When we look at these cases, you can see that there's basically no statistical, there's a little bit of a difference, but really no statistical difference between having the zygotic protein or not. The zygotic protein could not rescue the 1PGC phenotype. What's surprising, however, is that it basically completely rescued the germline size defect. So this is showing you different N minus, Z minus gonads in the adult, and you can see that they're smaller, that they're very small, whereas when we have zygotic XND1 expressed, we basically rescue the germline size. And when we look at the percentage of embryos basically with normal size, it's almost completely all of them, and very few have a small gonad. And so this was actually really actually surprising to baffling to me, was that what it means is that you need to is that it can sort of catch up from this maternal deficit, and that catch up was really that you need to have probably sustained XND1 function throughout development. I think what it was saying is that we need to be able to have XND1 So it was baffling to me, and what it's really saying is that the ability of XND1 to regulate cell cycle proliferation is sufficient to rescue whatever deficit those hatchies have in terms of allowing for the operation of the germline. And as far as we can tell, there were no other deficits in this animal. And that was just really striking to me. So what did happen, though, and this is showing this in another way, when we looked at the broods of these animals, whereas the overall brood was about 80 to 100, and you didn't have the zygotic protein, when we restore it, we basically restore to wild type. Okay. So now I want to switch gears yet again to go back to what XND1 is doing during early germline development. And I mentioned initially that we got into this by looking at the interaction, by seeing the similar expression pattern to nanos. And so what we really wanted to do is to see whether XND1 and nanos had similar phenotypes. But to genetically dissect this out, we needed to make a NOS2 mutation. And there wasn't one because the nanos gene itself is embedded within the intron of an essential gene known as HIM14. And so our way around that was to make a transgene, a phosmid, in which we actually knocked nanos out, but restored the function of HIM14. And when we did that, we also put YFP into the nanos locus so that we could actually track the primordial germ cells at the same time. Okay. And so when we looked at the interaction between XND1 and nanos, this is showing you XND1 mutant embryos, and germlines. What you can see here is a small germline, and then these large dappy blobs, I want to point out, those are normal embryos that look like, they're so bright, but really what happens is in a subset of these XND1 animals, we actually do see what I call the dappy blob phenotype, and this is what that looks like, and we don't understand that. What we see in XND1 NOS2 double mutant frequently is a failure to develop the germ cells at all. And so here's this tiny little rudiment of the developing germline, and this animal develops basically without a germline at all. And when we quantified this and we looked at both nanos1 and nanos2, we could see a significant synthetic interaction between these genes. So in wild type, basically all of the animals develop with a germline. So we're looking here at the percent of either sterility in blue or without a germline in red. And in XND1 mutants, rarely we see that they develop. Ooh, my axis went away. So these are 20, 40, 60, 80, 100%. So maybe in a little bit over 10% we see develop without a germline normally. In NOS1, we never see a defect, but in XND1, NOS1, we see no enhancement, which might suggest that NOS1 and XND1 are in the same pathway. With NOS2, even though RNAi has been reported to have high sterility, when we use this mutant allele that we generated, we saw very few steriles and very few without a germline. And then those colors are reversed. I apologize. The sterility is in the red and the no germline is in blue. In the XND1 NOS2, we see 50% of the population is sterile. And in NOS1, NOS2, we also see 50%, about 50% is sterile. But when we make a triple mutant and knock out XND1, NOS1, and NOS2, almost the entire population is sterile, almost all of them developing without a germline. And so what that tells us, one is that XND1 is in a separate pathway for germ cell development than the nanos proteins. But it also tells us that NOS1 and XND1 are not in the same pathway, which you might have seen over here with XND1. Rather, it looks like there's three pathways that are converging together, XND1 and NOS1 and NOS2. And I want to point out that I mentioned this different expression that NOS2 seems to have this very early expression, and then I suggested that it passes off this function to this later expression, NOS1. And so I'd like to suggest the possibility that maybe this synthetic interaction is actually NOS1, NOS2 having this handoff, right, where they provide 50% of the function, and then XND1 potentially providing this other 50% of this function required for germ cell development redundantly. Okay, so what do we know about how the nanos proteins are regulating germline development? Well, one of the key things that I mentioned early on that is required for PGC development is that you need to maintain transcriptional quiescence. And so we wanted to look to see whether there was a change in epigenetic marks that are associated with transcription and whether we could see aberrant transcription in the germline. And so I'm showing you here that we looked at H3K4 dimethylation, which have been seen in the nanos mutants. And so I'm showing you here, DAPI will be here in green, PIGL1 marking our germ cells, and H3K4 dimethylation. And you can see here in wild type that we don't see this. You can see in NOS2 in this image that we don't see it, and we quantified this in the next slide. And here in XND1, you can see that we do see this mark in the XND1 mutants, and we also see it here in the XND1 NOS2 double mutants. And when we quantified this, this is now the percentage of embryos that were positive. We do see a small percentage in wild type and NOS2 that had this modification. This is significantly elevated in XND1 and further elevated in XND1 double mutants or in the NOS1 NOS2 double mutant to upwards of 80% of the embryos. And we think that there's a direct correlation between the percentage of sterility and the percent of primordial germ cells that are positive for this modification, as plotted just by the similarity between these two lines. So is this actually functional for expression of somatic genes within the germline? And indeed it is. So I'm showing you here two different reporters, UNC119 GFP or UNC33 GFP. You can see here in wild type that we don't see GFP in the germline of these animals. Whereas here in XND1, you can start to see GFP within the germline, suggesting that these somatic markers had been aberrantly expressed in the XND1 mutant. And we would argue that that's in part because of the presence of the H3K4 dimethylation mark.
And is that also, is it just archetype, is that also at the transition from mitosis to meiosis?
The transition between mitosis and meiosis would be right here. So this is actually within the Pacatine region, and these are actually in developing oocytes. And here, this is the Pacatine region here, and then developing oocytes right there.
So different than the P granulose, which is in the mitotic cells.
That's right. Okay, so we're now trying to understand what XMD1 and NS are doing, and although I don't have any answers today for that, we're trying to explore, determine whether XMD1 and NS share target genes that are influencing fertility, or whether they're regulating unique sets of target genes that are themselves independently regulating fertility. So I want to switch gears then and talk about what XMD1 is doing in the adult germline. And I told you that we originally identified it for a role in crossover formation. So we originally identified it, and it's got its name from its effect on X chromosome non-disjunction. So it's called X non-disjunction factor 1, and we showed that it was required for X chromosome double-strand break formation. And what you can see here at diakinesis, we get the number of DAPB bodies shown here in green corresponds to the number of crossovers that have been formed. And so there's 6 pairs of chromosomes, and you get crossovers on all of the chromosomes. If you see more than 6 spots, it means that a pair of chromosomes hasn't gotten a crossover. And what we can see in the mutant is that the X chromosomes have separated from one another, suggesting that they have not had crossovers. But we knew that there are more than just defects in double-strand break formation per se. When we mapped where crossovers occurred along the chromosomes, in wild-type, crossovers are preferentially on the arms of the autosomes, with this middle region really repressed for crossovers. But in the XMD1 mutant, you can see that there's this basically flipping of the recombination map, so we elevate the number of crossovers in this middle region of the chromosome at the expense of the arms. We also saw a defect in double-strand break timing or repair kinetics, and I say one or the other because our marker here is RAD51, which is downstream of double-strand breaks. In the post-resection, you load RAD51, and that's required for strand exchange. But there's a direct correlation between the number of RAD51 foci and the number of breaks, and the really this is our best surrogate for looking at the breaks themselves. And what you can see here in wild type is that normally breaks or RAD51 foci peak in what we call region 2, the middle of pacotene, and I've quantified that here in these different regions along from the transition zone to the pacotene diplotene border. You can see the accumulation of RAD51 here in the middle. Whereas in the XMD1 mutant, right here past the transition zone, as they enter early pacotene, you can see this massive increase in the number of RAD51 foci, and when we quantify that, you can see that they basically reach peak levels really early. So there's 3 components that XMD1 seems to be regulating: breaks on the X chromosome, the distribution of breaks genome-wide, and the timing of those breaks. So we wanted to really explore what the nature of each of these defects was, and we knew that the crossover defect, the double-strand break defect on the X chromosome, was shared by another mutant called HIM5. And so I'm showing you here, let's just focus on this final column, looking at the percentage of males in the population. That's a reflection of if you fail to get a crossover on the X chromosome, the X's missegregate, males are XO, so you increase the percentage of males in the population due to defects in X chromosome crossover formation. In wild type, that's extremely rare, so you get very few males in the population. And in this weak allele of HIM5, this is E1467 for the worm aficionados in the crowd. We actually see about 20% males in XMD1. We also see about 20% males. But when we made the double mutants between this weak allele of HIM5 and XMD1, we also only saw 23% males, suggesting that these two genes appear to be in the same pathway. And when we looked at the localization of these proteins, we could see that HIM5 shown here and XMD1 shown here seem to have similar times that they came off in the germline. XMD1 seems to come on earlier than HIM5 in the adult germline, and I showed you earlier that it was in the primordial germ cells, and it's actually expressed in the germ cells and on DNA throughout development and comes off here at the pacotene diplotene border, and HIM5 seems to go off at the same point. But when we look in the XMD1 mutants, we notice that HIM5 appears to either be not expressed or not localized. So the similarities between the phenotypes and the effect of the XMD1 mutant on HIM5 localization suggested the possibility that XMD1 might directly regulate HIM5. So we looked in the XMD1 mutant looking at qPCR, and we can see that HIM5 levels, this is using 2 different control transcripts. So with either of these as controls, we can see that HIM5 levels are decreased in the XMD1 mutant. And then we made two different transgenes, one of which is its endogenous promoter driving HIM5 and a HIM5 GOP fusion protein, or an exogenous promoter that we thought might be independent of XMD1 regulation, and made the same HIM5 GOP transgene. And what we can see is that the using the transgene, that was the crap because I just put these together and I messed up the label. So let's look down here, where we basically make PI1 HIM5 transgene. We could look at GFP expression, and you can see that we see robust GFP expression normally and in the XMD1 mutant, whereas in the XMD1 mutant, we don't see it under its endogenous, and then these are mislabeled. So here's the EIS4 under the endogenous, and under the PI1, you can see that we see robust expression. So then we ask whether that can rescue, and what we can see in this background is when we topically express HIM5, we can see rescue of the crossover defect. So the transgene itself was fine for making crossovers. In the XMD1 mutant, I told you that we see a defect in crossover formation. And in these outcross strains, we're really only seeing about 15% of the population had 7 decustating bodies, so corresponding to a 8-10% non-disjunction rate. And you can see here when we rescue that we can suppress this quite a bit with the PI1 transgene, and it was not suppressible by the one that's not expressed in that background. So that really suggested that XMD1 appears to potentially function as a transcription factor for HIM5, and that it's acting on the endogenous HIM5 promoter to suppress its expression, whereas when we express it ectopically, we can rescue the crossover defect. So then XMD1, I mentioned, is expressed in the germline and appears to go off in the late Pacotine region. But what I didn't show you until now is that it's also predominantly expressed on the autosomes. And so I think you can see it better. There was, when we looked at the localization, you can see that there's this little green non-pink spot here. And that suggested that there was a single chromosome that was not potentially binding the XMD1 protein. And when we looked more closely, we realized that this was indeed the X chromosome. And so I'm showing you here a histone modification that preferentially localizes to autosomes. I'm showing you the XMD1 protein here in cyan, DNA here in green. And again, you can see that there's this green, non-pink, non-cyan chromosome, suggesting that XMD1 is excluded from binding the X chromosome. And so despite the fact that we see this effect on double-strand break formation on the X chromosome, this protein is predominantly localized to the autosomes. So I should point out that the failure to see an IF signal on the X chromosome does not mean it's not binding there. It just means that there's not enough intensity of that protein to be bound there. So there may be a little bit of protein on the X, but predominantly it is autosomally associated. Now that staining pattern is reminiscent of proteins that are involved in X chromosome gene silencing. So within the worm germline, the X chromosome is transcriptionally repressed. And so we asked immediately, does XMD1 regulate X chromosome gene silencing? And the answer is it does not. And so what I'm showing you here is this H3K4 dimethylation. You can see in wild type that we see this repressed X chromosome because it doesn't have this modification. And in the adult germline, we also see this, we don't see that the X chromosome is marked. So it's not desilencing the X chromosome, so that's not the reason for the X chromosome defect. And so we really started to think about what's happening to the X chromosome and how could we explain sort of these crossover defects and heterochromatin silencing. And so we sort of envisioned this idea that there's this class of ancestral proteins that are required to silence the X chromosome. And these are called the MES proteins. And so we thought maybe that what these MES proteins are doing is basically taking these X chromosomes here and putting them into a heterochromatic state. And maybe this heterochromatic state is not permissive for crossovers. And so it excludes the crossover machinery, and that what XMD1 basically does is come around and changes this from a really heterochromatic state to a slightly less heterochromatic state, which would allow occasional breaks to be made on the X chromosome. And so that way, if you got rid of X and D1, it went more heterochromatic and you wouldn't get breaks. But that there might be this yin and yang between X and D1 and the mess proteins. So we looked to see whether that was indeed the case by making double mutants. And what we can see here, this is now looking at the percentage of males in the population from X and D1 and these double mutants. Here, we can see 20% males in the population, MES2 had none. In the double mutants, MES2 suppressed the non-disjunction phenotype by X and D1, supporting this yin-yang idea of affecting the X chromosome. And we saw a similar effect with RNAi against MES3. So that really got us to look at the chromatin structure on the X chromosome, or sorry, in the X and D1 mutants. And what we can see here is when we basically threw our pile of histone antibodies that we had in the lab on the X and D1 mutant germlines to see if any were different. And what we saw was a difference in the acetylation of H2A on lysine 5. And so you can see wild type here, we see not a lot of staining, as high initially, goes off, and it comes on again a little bit here in the more proximal regions. And in X and D1, you can see that it's upregulated. And here we overexpress, oversaturated the image here to just show you the low staining in wild type and this robust staining in the X and D1 mutant. And these were taken at the same settings on the confocal microscope. So H2AK5 acetylation is a modification that most of you really know what's happening with. No, no. It's really one of these unknown modifications and its role. And this was actually the first in vivo assigned role of this modification. But what we do know is that it could be acetylated by the TIP60 complex. And the homolog of the TIP60 complex in C. elegans is a protein called MIS1. And so we wanted to know what the interaction of MIS1 was with this complex. And so what I'm showing you here is that MIS1 does affect the levels of this modification in the genome, but it is not the only, it is clearly not the only regulator of this modification, because in the absence of MIS1, we still see this modification. So I'm showing you here DAPI staining of our germlines. I've marked the mitotic to meiotic region. I'm showing you here our analysis of quantification of what will be in the early Pacatine region of this modification. And right away, you can see that there's low levels in wild type, low levels also in MIS1. We see maybe about 60% of the amount in the MIS1 mutant compared to wild type. We see elevated levels of this in X and D1. And you can see that that's reduced in the X and D1 MIS1. To also about 60%. So the effect of MIS1 is about a 30 to 40% reduction in this modification, both in wild type and in the X and D1 context. So is that functional? So we first addressed that using MIS1 RNAi, and what we can see in the MIS1 RNAi is the suppression of the crossover defect in X and D1, where we see an increase of 6 DAPI staining bodies in diakinesis. And then more recently, we've been using a very weak loss of function allele of MIS1. And so MIS1 is an essential gene. It actually can cause sterility, and the deletion allele causes sterility. So I can't actually say it's essential. It's required for fertility. We don't know about its embryonic roles because we can't get past the sterility phenotype. And so there's this weak loss of function allele that was initially identified for its role in volvo cell development. And so there's a tiny effect of this itself on somatic volvo development. There was no known role of it within the germline. So because it was the only allele we could get our hands on, we decided, well, let's see if there's an interaction with X and D1. So when we made double mutants of X and D1 with this weak allele of MIS1, we saw improved fecundity, both in terms of the percentage of eggs. So wild type, here's MIS1, it has no effect. X and D1 has reduced, and we see an increase, albeit small, in the X and D1 MIS1 double. We see an increase in the total brood, and a decrease in the percent of lethal embryos. Surprisingly, we did not see an effect in the frequency, a suppression of the male frequency in X and D1 versus X and D1 MIS1 with this weak allele. But we did see other effects. We saw a profound change in the double-strand break timing. So before I showed you basically these two images that in wild type we see the peak around 51. So sorry, here's the mitotic to meiotic region within the germline. So Daffy is shown here to show you basically that transition. And then you can, and this arrow marks where we basically start to see rad 51 foci. And then I've marked really where we start to see the peak of rad 51 foci. So you can look at basically the difference between the solid line and the dotted line as the, how long it takes to accumulate rad 51. And what you can see is in XMD1, these two lines are one on top of another. And you can see that there's a lot of rad 51 foci, but in this one, you can see that this that there's a gap again. And so this is really, and then in the mutant, we see this gap as well. And so that really tells us that MIS-1 is suppressing this double-strand break timing in XMD1. We also saw that XMD1 itself is sensitive to gamma irradiation. So when we're looking at percent survival with different doses of irradiation, here's our wild-type killing curve in the XMD1 mutant. We see that they're sensitive to irradiation, but that's completely suppressed by MIS-1. And this is showing you MIS-1 itself is not sensitive, nor is this XMD1 MIS-1 with this weak loss of function allele. So despite the fact that this allele has virtually no effect by itself, it has this profound effect on these various aspects of XMD1 biology. There may be a slight impact of MIS-1 on the 1PGC phenotype because we see a mild reduction in the percentage of embryos with the 1PGC phenotype, which might be an impact on the deposition of proteins that are required for these early embryonic division. I want to point out as well that the regulation of HIM5 by XMD1 is independent of MIS-1. So there's these components like the timing of double strand breaks and the fecundity and total that are regulated by MIS-1, and then this other component, the male phenotype, that seems to be explained by HIM5. And I'm showing you here this transgene. Here's the EIS4 transgene, so it's the HIM5 expressing HIM5 GFP. It's not regulated by MIS-1. It's reduced in the XMD1 mutant, and it's not brought back up by MIS-1. Right, so it cannot restore the expression of HIM5 by knocking out MIS-1. So it's not. So it seems that the regulation of some components are independent of MIS-1 and some are directly regulated by MIS-1. So I just want to finish by telling you a tiny bit about our RNA-seq data. And so we really needed to try to understand how XMD1 is functioning. And so we started to do RNA-seq and in collaboration with ModEncode to do ChIP-seq. And I'm showing you, I don't have beautiful pie charts, in part because the data doesn't warrant that, and in part because I am challenged by trying to understand this data. But when I look at basically XMD1 compared to wild type, we see 42 genes that are twofold or more downregulated, and those include two of my favorite genes. One is HIM5, which we expected. Another is SUN1, which is also a meiotic regulator of chromosome movements, and a protein called LIB1, which is regulating MAP kinase signaling at the pacotene to diplotene border. If we extend this to 1.5-fold, it's 112. So there's not a lot of genes that are regulated by XMD1 or DEC. Now, there's about 100 that are upregulated, and nothing on there is actually particularly interesting in terms of classifications or families or go terms or anything that I want to tell you about. What's interesting about the downregulated genes is around half of them actually show XMD1 at the promoter, half of them don't, but only 3 of the upregulated genes have XMD1 at the promoter, and those also have XMD1 across the gene body. So there seems to be a difference in the localization of XMD1 in the up versus down genes. But mostly, the upregulated genes are probably indirect targets based on the fact that they don't seem to be chipping XMD1.
Was MIS-1 in that list?
And MIS-1 was not on that list.
Okay, I'm confused now, but we can talk about that.
So we don't think so. So MIS-1 may not be on the list because XMD1 may not directly regulate MIS-1. The ability of XMD1 to regulate H2AK5 may be through regulating a different either acetyltransferase or deacetylase. right? So it could be directly inhibiting the deacetylase, which would increase the acetyl levels, and then this one could be then coming in doing its job, 30% reduction, right, or in the mutant, reducing the levels 30% or 40%, right? So I don't think MIS-1 is a direct target of XMT1. I think that our ability to modulate the chromatin structure through changing MIS-1 is what's impacting this. But I'll come to the MIS-1 in just 1 second. So I just want to show you, these are not the most astounding peaks of XMT1 here in red at the promoters, but this is showing you that it's sitting basically right near the promoter of some of our favorite genes. But we did go ahead and look at comparing XMT1 and XMT MIS-1 RNA-seq. So this is the data I just told you about. This allele of MIS-1 does, I should say these are dissected germlines, does nothing in the germline, like transcriptionally. It is doing nothing. There are 5 genes that are 2- to 3-fold downregulated. There are 4 genes that are 2- to 2-fold upregulated. That's it. Nothing, right? But when you take XMT1 and you put it in the context of this gene that is doing nothing, and you compare then the XMT MIS-1 versus XMT1, we get incredible and huge changes into the germline transcriptome, right? Now we're starting to see 400 or 500 genes that are 2-fold down, 1,000 genes that are 1.5-fold down-regulated, 500 that are upregulated. Okay, and if we look at what these genes are, the down-regulated genes include some really exciting things. They include small RNA pathways, and shockingly, bafflingly, DNA repair genes. And the reason that's baffling is that I just told you that MIS-1 suppresses the IR sensitivity of XMT1. And so you would have expected these would have been in the opposite direction. And so we're really like hitting our heads against the wall, right? So this is a work in progress, right? I don't understand what this means, but what I think it's telling us is that there's profound changes and we really don't understand the relationship between the changes at the transcriptome level and the physiological responses to those changes. Or maybe they're, with a nod to those studying translation in the audience, translational effects on these genes as well. And then so lastly, I just want to say two small things. One is, so it appears that XMT1 is really seem to be primed to changes in chromatin structure. And two pieces that support that is that when we've started now putting XMT1 together with a bunch of these other chromatin factors. So when we make XMT1 double mutants with this protein MES4, which is one of these other X chromosome silencing genes, and I showed you the data for MES2 and MES3, but when we put it together with MES4, what happens is that XMT1 enhances the sterility of MES4, and we can see that, so now even heterozygotes of XMT1 increase the percentage of MES4 animals that have a small germline, not as grand maternal sterile, but as F1 sterile. And then when we make SET17 doubles with XMT1, whereas both genes have a reduction in germline, we see actually an enhancement of the sterility in XMT1 17. And we start and at least 4 other combinations of XMT1 with chromatin factors are having profound effects on XMT1 fertility, sterility. And so we really think that this gene is giving us, will give us a lens into trying to understand the chromatin environment within the germline. And so I just want to leave you with I'll call it my ball and stick model, where we have this unique localization of XMT1 on the autosomes. And then we have this role of XMT1 in various aspects of crossover formation. And I've showed you that we can at least suggest that HIM5 is responsible for some of the X chromosome crossover defects. But there's also a component of epigenetics that's regulating other aspects of crossover formation, in particular XMT1 timing. And I suggested that this epigenetic effect, because we can see potentially a partial suppression of the cell cycle defect, the 1PGC phenotype by MIS-1, regulating cell cycle, and also DNA damage repair. And so lastly, I want to thank the group and point out in particular Maine Paul Rana, who did all of the work on the 1PGC phenotype, and then Brooke McClendon, who really worked on the adult germline of XMD1, and my funding, and you for your attention.
What stage of development are you looking at?
Yeah, right, so what we do is we expose adults and then we look at the impact on the developing eggs. So nematodes, because they're not dividing, are incredibly resistant to radiation to the effect of 5,000 rays, which is, you know, 10,000 double-strand breaks to their genome, and they'll survive for a day with that. So we don't do those assays. We basically irradiate, and 200 rays will sterilize a worm. So we start to look at 20, 50, 100 rays and the impact, the ability to repair that, to pass it on to the next generation, because you hit a threshold effect that rather than apoptosing those oocytes, you still make, you make an oocyte that is damaged.
So I noticed on the other end of your model, but have you tried to see if you can rescue the 1PGC phenotype with overexpression of HIM5? Is that?
It does not rescue.
It doesn't, okay.
Sorry, I'm trying to understand. So you have the knockdown of the mutant with one, you have genes that go up and down, and then when you do the double, you have tenfold higher numbers of ones go down. What exactly is happening here?
Right. So what?
A change in the epigenetic.
So that's what we think. I showed you this really profound change in H2AK5 acetylation, right? There's this huge change in the level of this modification within the genome. And then this allele of this one, which is literally doing nothing to the germline, profoundly changes it. But it's changing H2AK5 levels. But you would have expected that, if anything, it would have brought XMD1 to look like wild type, because when you look at the staining of this modification. So there are other, so clearly that tells us that there's probably other modifications that are changed, and you only see what you look for. So one question is, should we do histone profiling to see the different modifications in XMD1, right? The other thing is MIS1 affects other modifications that seem not to be affected, at least by IF in XMD1, and it could be affecting those which have a profound effect. But that XMD1 might be primed, right, to be sensitive to any other changes in chromatin organization, and then the transcriptome just goes haywire. But phenotypically, I can show you the XMD1 MIS worms, and they look so much like, happier, they're more fertile, they really are better. But I'll show you, the brood size is still only 100. So there's still an impact on the brood size, which is not the MIS1 brood size. It's really, it's suppressing, but not completely. So there's still effects, and it's probably a total of all of those. But we thought maybe we screwed up and we switched the samples, right? But the good thing about RNA-seq is you could test that because you have mutations, and you can ask where's your point mutations, and the samples were right.
You said the MIS1 was just kind of like you happen to have it laying around. Is that right?
It was the only other mutation in that gene besides the deletion that's available, that exists.
Okay, because I was thinking about, you know, with its role in mobile development and then the timing of XMD1, that those two things, that seems to happen at about the same time, right? So like that L3-L4 stage for mobile development, and then where your germline would be at that point. So that seems to be the point where MIS1 would start to be.
I don't know when the requirement in mobile development. So there is the proliferation at these early stages, but there's definite morphogenesis, so it could be L4 stage that it's required. I'm not sure about that. But the defects that we're seeing, MIS1 is suppressing, like that timing is in the adult germline, right, the timing of double-strand break formation. If it's impacting the 1PGC phenotype, that's a oocyte, presumably an oocyte affecting what transcripts are going into the oocyte, maybe. So I don't think it's as simple as the timing of the requirement somatically versus within the trauma.
All right. Well, thank you. Great presentation.
Thanks.